So let's continue with yesterday's stuff. So yesterday we covered a lot of new things, right? A lot of regular expressions and how to use sed. So I'll just remind you in case you forgot what we covered yesterday. So we covered some regular expression, special keywords, special meta characters. We covered the plus character and the capturing brackets, okay? And we had slash w and slash b. Hope you remember what these were for, right? This is a word boundary and this is a word character, okay? Capturing parenthesis and the plus, what does plus do? Plus one or more of the previous pattern. And so when you're having capturing parenthesis, you'll also have a back reference. Yeah, so back references can be anything. So we also talked about addresses for sed. So we were just beginning with that before we ran out of time. So how do you specify an address? So here before the command you pass to sed, okay? We're giving an address over there. So that address tells sed which lines to operate on, right? So in this particular line, we're telling sed to perform this command only on the lines other than 2. So you remember the exclamation mark negates the address. So in the previous command, this sed command is run only for line 2. And in this one, it's run for every command except line 2. Okay, so the last, just remind you where we stopped yesterday. You remember what we needed to do was, we want to delete all the blank lines from this file, right? So we had some blank lines. We want to get rid of those lines. So we want to write a sed script that finds these blank lines and removes them. So we looked at the d command. The d command for sed just deletes a line. And we need to restrict the d command only to the lines that are empty. So that's what we want to do. So you know what addresses are. Now you can put addresses in this form also. You remember I told you yesterday. So you can put an address like 2, 5, which will perform the command for the lines 2 up to 5, including both. Okay. Now this is the kind of address that we need right now. It's called it's a regular expression. So if you put an address like this, so you notice that the regular expression is between forward slashes. Okay. So this itself is an address. So if you have an address like this, what does it do? It performs a command when that regular expression matches that line. So you remember the sed cycle? The sed cycle reads one line from input, okay? And then it performs the commands, whether that's substitution or deletion, whatever. And then at the end of the cycle, it prints out that line. Then it goes to the next line and does the same thing. So if you put an address like this, the execution cycle changes a bit, it reads the line, and then it checks if this regular expression matches that line. So if you had a regular expression with just a plain word in it, like THE, it's going to check whether the character's THE is present in that line. And if it's present, if it finds a match, the command is executed. So we're going to use this to restrict our delete command so that it only removes the empty lines. Now to match an empty line, this is a regular expression you're going to use, right? Very small. So what does the caret sign and the dollar sign match? So you remember I told you yesterday that the slash b is a zero width pattern, zero width. Okay, it doesn't match a character. It only matches a position, right? It matches a position, the boundary between a word and a non-word character, right? So the caret and the dollar sign, which are the meta characters in regular expressions, they're also zero width matches. Okay, they don't actually match any real text. They only match certain positions. So the caret matches the beginning of your line. Okay, right now we're saying line, but that's not perfectly accurate, but just assume, in the case of sed, we're talking about lines. So the caret matches the beginning of a line, okay, the position just before the first. For example, if you're looking at this file, the caret is going to match this position, okay, just this position on each line. So on line 1, it's going to match this position. On line 2, it's going to match this position. So it's just the position just before the first character of that line. The dollar sign is similar, but it does the exact same thing, but at the end of the line. Okay, so it matches this position, just at the end of the last character. Okay, here. Okay. So how do you use this? So maybe is it clear how they work? So I'll just show you a little example on the terminal of what they do. So look at this line. I'm just putting four sets of the character AB. AB, AB, four times. And echo, what does echo do? It writes it to standard output. The standard output is pipe to input of set. Now what does the set command do? We're using the S command, which we talked about yesterday. What does the S command do? The S command looks for the pattern AB. Okay, and when it sees an AB, it replaces it with XX. And we give the flag G. You remember the G and I flag? The G is for global. Replace every occurrence of the pattern in your line. I is for case insensitivity. You don't need that here. So what does it do? It's going to start scanning our input. It's going to find an A and a B. Okay. So we found a match. It's going to replace it with XX. Now since we get a G, it's not going to stop. It's going to continue scanning. So it's going to scan again. It's going to find A, B, replace it with XX. It's going to do this. So what do you get? You're going to get a bunch of X's. Right? Now suppose I put this, okay, this anchor over here. Okay, that's what does the caret match? It's supposed to match this position, right? This position. So what's the set going to look for? It's going to look for this position first, okay, and then it's going to look for an A and a B, right? So it's going to find a match and it's going to replace these two A's with X. Now we have a G. Right, we have the G command, so it's not going to stop, it's going to continue. But what is it going to look for next? It's going to look for the zero bit match again. It's going to look for this position again. But that position doesn't exist over here, right? Because the caret match is only at the beginning of the string. So it's going to fail. So what's it going to do? You're going to get only one set. Okay? It replaces only the first set of X's. Okay? So what does this caret do? We call it an anchor. It anchors your match to the beginning of the line. Now the dollar sign does the exact same thing, it anchors your match to the end of the line. So where will you put the dollar sign? You put it at the end of your, right? That's going to anchor it to the end. Okay, so your set is going to scan, it finds A, it finds B, now it's looking for the end of line anchor, but it doesn't find it over here. Now it's going to go to the next, it's going to keep scanning, finally it's going to reach here, it finds A, B, and also finds the dollar, okay, the end of line position. So it matches and it's going to replace that with X's. So you see, so I think the effect of the caret and the dollar sign is clear now. So let's use that. So what does this mean? So this means beginning of a line, end of line, with nothing in between. So that's an empty line. Empty line is, it has a beginning and end, but nothing in between, no characters in between. So we're using that. Now, technically, dollar does not match the end of line, it actually matches the end of a string. Okay, but in sed, since sed is always working in terms of lines, it always reads one line at a time, our end of string is the end of line itself. Right? So what happens when you run this command? So, the original file was a few slides ago, so I'll tell you what happened. It removed a few of the empty lines, but not all of them. Okay, it removed a few of the empty lines, but a few are remaining. So what do you think the reason is why it did not remove some of the lines?
Syntax maybe?
Yeah, so there might be some, so we're looking for a beginning of line and end of line, nothing in between. So if the regular expression is not matching, that means something is there on those lines. Right, something is there. That's why it's not matching these lines. So what could be there? It could be spaces or tabs. So spaces and tabs and a few other characters, they're called white space characters. They're called white space. That means they don't show up on your screen. Okay, and when you print, they don't show up there. But they're actually stored in the file. So we'll have a space character and a new and a tab character actually present in the file. But when you view the file on the screen, they won't show up. They're non-printing characters. Because, so there are a lot of characters which are called white space. There is a new line character, the tab, space, line field, form field, okay? But the most common ones you'll find are the space and the tab. Right? So you'll notice that when you press a tab key, what happens? The cursor moves many spaces forward. But how many characters are actually stored in the file? Just one. Okay, so a tab character is just one character, okay? One ASCII byte. Okay, but depending on which program you're using to read that file, that tab is translated as one or more spaces. Okay? But actually in the file, in the data of the file, a tab is just one character. So now we need to fix our script so that it finds lines which are empty, plus it finds lines which have white space in it. Okay, only white space, without any other printing characters. So let's change our script. So we need to remove space and tabs, right? So let's start with spaces alone. Let's assume we have some lines which have some spaces in it, right? Just spaces, no tabs. How will we remove that? So we'll use this. So it's exactly the same as the earlier one. We have a caret to anchor our match to the beginning. We have a dollar to anchor it to the end. Then we added something in between. We added a space. There's a space here. Okay. There's a space character and a star meta character. A star meta character. So we didn't talk about star yesterday, right? We didn't talk about star. So you remember what plus was for? Plus was for what? One or more repetitions of the previous pattern. What does star stand for? Star stands for zero or more repetitions of the previous character. Previous pattern. So when you put a star here, what does it mean? It means zero or more. Okay, zero or more spaces. Now remember, it's zero or more. That means suppose you had a line which had no spaces in it. Okay, so what's Sed gonna do? It's gonna look at the line. It's gonna find the start of line anchor. It's gonna look for spaces, but it's not gonna find any. But the star tells Sed that even if you don't find any spaces, it's okay. It's a match. Because the star says zero or more. That means even if Sed is not able to find a space, that is also a successful match. But if you put a plus over there and there were no spaces in your file, in your line, it's gonna fail. Because it has to find at least one space. Right? But suppose we put a plus there, what's gonna happen to our program? It's going to catch lines with spaces in it, but it's not going to find empty lines, lines with no spaces. So if you put a star, it's going to find lines, both type of lines. That is lines with nothing in it, and it's also going to find lines with one or more spaces in it. Okay, so the star stands for one or more. So suppose you had 10 spaces in your line. Okay, it's going to match that too. So that line will also match. And it's going to delete it. Now, the star character, like I told you, it's in your basic regular expressions, you do not need to escape the star character. You can just type it as it is. But for the plus, you remember you had to put a backslash. So done. So we fixed one problem. It removes spaces. Now let's do this for tabs also. Okay. What about lines which have one or more tabs in it, tab characters? So instead of the space, we put the slash t. So slash t stands for the tab character. Yeah, this is also an escape sequence set. When set sees slash t, it substitutes a tab, the actual tab ASCII character over there. So it's gonna look for zero or more tab characters on your line. Is that clear? Mm-hmm. It works in exactly the same way as the earlier one, space. So this line is gonna remove lines which have tabs in it. It's gonna remove empty lines because we have a star. It's going to remove empty lines, plus it's going to remove lines which have one or more tabs in it. But suppose you have a line which have tabs and spaces, okay? Suppose it has a combination of tabs and spaces, like five tabs and five spaces. Now you want to find both. So now we're going to use a feature of regular expressions called alternation. So we're going to use this character bar. So what does that mean? So the bar is the alternation meta character. So suppose you have a pattern over here. So this pattern can be a complete regular expression, right? You can have a complete regular expression here and a complete regular expression here. and if you put a bar in between, it says match this or this, okay, any one of them. This one or this one. So suppose it doesn't find, suppose you are, suppose cyber scanning through your text and it doesn't find rejects one. In that case, it looks for rejects two. It looks for, it doesn't find the first one, it looks for the second one. Now, the pipe symbol also needs to be escaped, just like the plus. Okay, so let's use that. So how do we do that? So, can you see this line? So, we have our beginning of line anchor. We have our dollar sign, which anchors it to the end of the line. And we have our star. But what do we have before the star? We have a space, okay, there's a space, and our pipe, we have to escape it with a backslash, and our tab. So that says space or tab. Now we've enclosed it in brackets, okay, and you put a star over there. Now you remember that the brackets are for capturing the match, remember? Right? It's for capturing the match. But over here, we really don't need to capture anything. But the parenthesis has another effect. So you know, in math, what do you do when you want to group statements? You put them in brackets, right? When you want to associate things. So it's exactly the same thing we're doing here. So over here, we're not using brackets because we want to capture things. We're using it because we want to group it. So why are we grouping this over here in between this parenthesis?
The stars.
Yes, exactly. So we want the star. So suppose you did not put the parenthesis over there. And the star would be applicable only to the tab character. But we want the star to be applicable to a space or a tab. So we want to find zero or more occurrences of space or tab. Right? Now what's the difference between this? Okay, space, star, or tab, star. What's the difference between this and this? Is it the same?
Their spaces will be together and tabs will be together in this one.
Right. So this one can find only either or, okay? It can find lines with all spaces in it or lines with all tabs in it, but not lines which have both spaces and tabs. Is it different? Is the difference clear? So you have a star which is applicable to a space, that means one or more. So your set is going to scan through your text. It's going to look for spaces. Once it finds a space, it's going to look for more spaces. But once it finds at least one space over here, this match has passed. Now it's not going to look for this because we put an OR over here. So since we found some spaces, it's not going to look for tabs. So same thing happens if you had tabs in your line. If it's going to find one or more tabs, this part of the match is going to pass. And it's not going to find any of the space. It won't match any space. But that's not what we want. We want to find a combination of tabs and spaces. So that's why we put the star outside of the brackets.
He is asking, can we put AND operator?
AND operator over where?
No,
there's no. So if you type a regular expression AB, that's AND, right? And so you want to find an A followed by a B. Okay? Right? So if you want to alternate, you want to put a pipe over there. So there's no AND operator. So is this regular expression clear? So this regular expression is supposed to do what we want. It's going to match lines which are empty. It's going to match lines which have one or more tabs in it. It's going to match lines which have one or more spaces in it. And it's also going to match lines which have a combination of tabs and spaces in it. So we'll run this. If you run this on our input, it's going to remove all lines. So I'm not showing it to you, but it does the job. Now there's a more compact way to write this. Now we're alternating between a space and a tab. Now you remember character classes? We talked about character classes yesterday, remember? Something like this. So what does this stand for?
Any one of these,
right? It means A or B or C. Now we have two characters here, space or tab. Right? So we can use the syntax over there. So if you use the syntax over there, it becomes a little more compact, more readable. Inside the square brackets, we just put a space and a tab. So that means match either a space or a tab, and we have a star operating on that. Now, what's the difference between this and the pipe? I mean the bar. Now difference is that if you put a character class, you can only specify single characters. You can match only one single character. But earlier I showed you that if you use a pipe, you can put a complete regular expression over here. Okay, so this regular expression can be another big regular expression which has its own pipes in there. It has its own bar and star and whatever inside. Okay, so you can put really a big regular expression there and a big expression and you can alternate between them. But you can't do that for a character class. Right, so this is just a convenience if you're using the common case of alternating between single characters. So this is a compact way to remove empty lines from any file. Now we move on to sed scripts. Now you remember the bash? You remember bash, how we used to write scripts into a file and make it executable and run it? You can do the same thing. Sometimes your sed scripts can become really big. So I'll tell you one thing. Suppose you want to replace the word TEH with THE, and you want to replace something IT with XX, something like that. Okay. So we have two substitute commands. So you can type this on the command line just like this. Okay? You can type sed, and you can put the. You can do this. So for every line in your input, it's going to execute this command first, and then this command. So first it's going to substitute with it's going to substitute TH with THE, and then it's going to substitute IT with XX. Now suppose you wanted to restrict this to line number 2. Remember? What are you going to do? You're going to put a 2 over here. Now if you want to restrict this one also to line number 2, you have to put line number 2 over here. So there's an easy way to group. Suppose you had more than 2, you had 5. And you want to restrict all of them to some particular line number, you can enclose them in a block. So inside the block looks like this. You just put your address over here. This is our address. It can be a regular expression. And you put curly braces. So now both of these commands will operate only for line number 2. Okay, so if you want to group one or more commands under a single address, you use braces. So what's the difference between this address and this address? Yeah. Suppose I put an address like this, 2, and I put another address with just a...
It's the second line and it's the second 2 character.
Yeah, so this will work for second line, right? And this will work for any line that contains the character 2. So remember, when you have a regular expression, you have to enclose it in forward slashes.
Where are the quotes when I use the curly bracket?
Okay, if you're writing it on the command line, the quotes should be outside. Okay? Yeah, you don't need the quotes. That's correct. The quotes should be outside. So we're putting the quotes there so that we protect it from the shell. Right? So
yesterday you told us you do minus E if you're writing so many regular expressions.
Ah, yes. Yes, so you can write this as 2 bits. But then you have the problem that you can't group it under a base. So suppose you had this as two separate commands, you can split it over the line by putting a hyphen E over here. Right? Like this. So it's just a convenience. So this will execute these instructions for every line. First this, then this. Whichever order they appear. So we were talking about sed scripts. How will you write a script in a file? So you type your script exactly how you would, like a bash script. You open a file, for example, let's suppose we want a file for our the TEH one. This one. We want to put it in a file. So what you do is you open a file in an editor, anything, and you'll put the address that you want, you'll put an opening curly brace, and write the line that you want. Close the brace. Now the simplest script file that you can create is just this line alone. So you can, suppose you had a really big substitution line, you could just put that line in a file and save it. No places, no addresses, nothing. It's gonna, and then how do you run the script file? So suppose you save this as a Vim script, suppose you save it as sed script.sed. You can give it a sed extension so that it's easy for you to recognize. If you want to run this, you just type sed hyphen f, small f, and the script file name. So sed script. So this is convenient. Suppose you had a large number of substitutions that you needed to do, and it's difficult to type all of them on the command line all the time. You can write something like this. So if you don't have an address, suppose you want your substitution to happen on all lines, you can just put each set. You can put each substitution command on its own line. Okay, and just put in a file, and then you can run it like that. So simple, right? So when you put the F command, sed is going to read its commands from the file.
Ishaan, in a Sales Bashir script also, you can use the comment itself, right? This is only for if I want to use the sed command only.
Right. So if you want sed to read its commands from a file, you have to use sed hyphen F. Of course, since sed is a program that reads from standard input and writes to standard output, you can use it inside a pipeline, you can use it inside the shell script. So even over there, even if you're using inside a shell script, you can use the F option. So then sed itself is going to read this command from somewhere else. Or you can put the command right there in single quotes. So we're coming to the end of our session. So there are some things which we didn't cover, some regular expression meta characters that we didn't cover. So we finished the star. Okay, and now there's one more regular expression meta character called question mark. Now this is exactly like the star and the plus. So you remember the plus is one or more, the star is zero or more. The question mark is zero or one. Okay, zero or one occurrence of whatever comes before. Now you remember I always said that the plus modifies the pattern which comes before it. And the star modifies a pattern. So I didn't say character, I said pattern. So before a star, you can put any regular expression here. Okay, you can put some large regular expression like that, that's one. So the star applies to that whole thing. Okay. So the same thing goes for the question mark and the plus. They modify whatever pattern comes before them, they modify that. So the plus, the question mark stands for zero or one. And there's another important meta character that we didn't cover, and that is just the period, okay, just the dot. So what does that mean? You remember in the glob expressions? You remember globs we used question mark? Yeah. So what is that? Any single character, right? Any single character. That's the same meaning over here. Okay. So dot means any single character. But now since dot means any single character, what does this mean? What does dot star mean? Any number of characters. So if you used this inside your regular string, what would it catch inside set?
Lines.
It would catch the entire line. Okay, so if you put this in capturing brackets, this would capture the entire line from the beginning till the end. Now you need to escape the question mark also. The dot does not need to be escaped. And there's one more type of regular expression. So suppose I put a word like DEH, okay? And I put a star over here. Okay, this means zero or more occurrences of DEH. And suppose I want to restrict the number of matches. Suppose I want to look for between 3 and 5 matches. Instead of 0 to infinity or 1 to infinity or 0 and 1, I want to search for between 3 and 5. So in that case, there's one syntax. You use a curly brace and you put a 3, comma 5. That means it's going to look for 3. It's going to look for at least 3 and at most 5 occurrences of this. Okay, it should be consecutive. It should be together. Suppose you omit the 5. Suppose you just put 3, comma and brace. That means 3 to infinity. Okay, more than 3. At least 3, or any number more than that. And you can omit this also, and you can put something like this. That means 0 to 5. Right? So if you wanted to simulate a star with this, what would you write? Okay, that's not a star. Suppose you want to simulate a plus. You want a plus, you want this to work like plus. What would you write inside the brackets?
1, comma.
Anybody else? So you want to get, what does plus mean? 1 or more? That means your limit, your upper limit is infinity, any number. What's your lower limit, your minimum?
Just
1, right? So what do you put over here?
Just 1.
Yeah, you put 1, comma, that's it. Okay, so this behaves exactly like this. Okay, so that does it with Sed.
Taking the shell scripture, we did something like we can simultaneously apply any script on multiple files. Like we use the shift command.
Right.
Took the input and then again we were given command line arguments.
Yes.
Can we do something like that in Sed?
So Sed, the Sed command, what's the Sed command syntax? The Sed command syntax, if you look at the man page, I don't remember exactly. So the Sed command is like this, program, and file. So this is how you provide a Sed command. You give a Sed command, you give a program. So the program is our S command, you remember? That S slash T E H T H E. That's what goes here. And then you provide one or more file names, or none. Because this is optional. You provide one or more file name. So if you provide more than one file name over here, Sed is going to loop over all the files. So it's going to perform this operation on all the lines of file 1, then immediately on all the lines of file 2, okay, and then it's going to output that. Okay. So you'll get the concatenation of all of them as the output. So one thing that's not in the notes is, suppose you want to, so you remember a TEH-THE correction program? Suppose you want to correct the output of your file. Suppose you had a file named some text.txt, and you want to pipe this through Sed so that it removes all your typos. You pipe it through Sed. Okay, you have a Sed program here. And then what you can do is you can write this out to another file, right? Suppose you do this. Okay. What's gonna happen? So this is a common mistake which is done in the shell.
Cannot write that.
The file will be empty.
Yeah. Okay. This is not something that you can intuitively know. It's how the Unix shell works. So if you take a file, okay, and you pipe the output back into, if you redirect the output back into that file, okay, this file is going to have nothing in it. It's going to be empty. Why? Because if the shell sees output redirection, okay, this, what does this do? The greater than, it outputs standard output. It redirects standard output into a file. Right? So if you use the greater standard output redirection operator, what it does is before the shell runs this command, before it does anything with this command, before it actually runs this command, it's going to create this file first. It's going to create this file first. And once the file is created, then it's going to run these commands and then redirect the output to this file. Now the effect of doing this is that since it's creating a file, if that file contained any data, it's going to be truncated to zero length. Okay, so you're going to lose all the data. So you can't do this. If you did this, before the cat command can ever run, your file has been reduced to zero length. It contains no data. So this is something you need to avoid. So how can we overcome this using Sed? You can maybe give another file name, but Sed has an option which makes it convenient. Sed has an option called, so instead of writing this command like this, you could type sed-i, your program, and the file name. So what does the I command say? It says this, read the input of this file, okay, perform your program, your substitutions on it, and then write the output back into that file. So sed takes care of this. So internally what sed does is actually it stores the output in a temporary file. And as soon as your substitutions and processing of the file is complete, it renames that file back to your old name. So that's how it works internally. But there is a safe way to edit your file in place. So the I stands for in place. So you don't have to make a second copy of your file containing the output. And suppose you want to do a whole lot of substitutions. Now if you provide it some name over here, so what does this command do? It's going to replace this file with your output. But suppose you wrote a bad regular expression and it somehow replaced your entire text with something which you don't want. Okay, so you can, if you put something like this, like .txt, okay, i.txt, this is a parameter to the I command, the I option. What it does is going to keep a backup of your file. Okay, so put it, maybe a better option to give back. Okay, so I for i.back. What it does is it's gonna replace your original file with the output, but it's also gonna create a backup of your original one. So suppose your file name is text.txt, there's gonna be a new file in your directory called text.txt.back. So text.txt is gonna have your processed output, and text.txt.back is gonna have your original one. But if you don't provide this, there's gonna be no backup. It's going to just replace. So I haven't written this in the notes, but you can just write it down.
In the previous one, instead of giving 1 greater than, if I give 2 greater than, will the output will be the end of the file?
2 greater than. Are you talking about
appending the output to a file?
Yes, so that can have undesirable effects because, so cat is continuously reading your file and piping it into sed, right? And you're at the same time you're adding lines, so it's going to read those same lines and you're going to get like an infinite loop. So that can happen. So we're done with sed. If there are any questions on sed, maybe take now. We're going to move into the next utility called awk. Okay, let's begin with awk. So awk, just like sed, awk is also a stream processing program. It reads input from standard input, performs some kind of processing, and writes it to standard output. But awk is a lot more flexible than sed. Although you don't use awk and sed for doing the same thing, sed has its uses, and awk has other uses. I'll tell you about that. But awk is a complete programming language. Okay, so this capital AWK is actually a programming language that was created a long time ago. What do you mean by complete programming languages? You can actually write large programs in it. So it contains an if condition, it contains loops, it contains while loop, do loop, everything. Okay, you can even write functions in awk. So awk is a complete programming language. But we're going to show you a very small subset of that language. So we're going to show you the subset of awk where you're going to use it to process input. So we're not going to write large programs in awk like we wrote in a shell. We're going to write little programs that what they do, they read some data from standard input, perform some transformation on it, and write it to output. But awk, the expressive power of awk is a lot more than sed. You can do a lot more with awk. So that become clear with the examples. Awk is particularly suited for processing files which are structured. So what do you mean by structured? Suppose you had some data which was read by some instrument, and that data collects information like once per second. Now it's going to write all its data on one line. So second one, all your information on one line. Second two, all the information. So you'll get a file which is arranged in columns. So that's a structured file. So you know you can navigate this file. You know for second 55, go to line number 55. Field number 2 is your data. Okay, awk is particularly suited for working on files like that. Let's see how it does this. This is our example file. It's the same one we used earlier. So I'm just using cat to write the output. So you have one column of characters and three columns of floating point numbers. Now this is a really simple awk script. Okay, you're piping the output of the cat command into awk. And this is what an awk program looks like. You remember in sed I told you about the brackets starting and ending a block. So in awk also you can have blocks. But in awk the block is sort of compulsory. You need at least one block in your program. So this is that block. Okay, the first block. So you have an opening brace that opens a block. And a closing brace. And you can put your commands, your statements inside that block. So you need at least one block in your awk program. So look at this awk program, it doesn't do anything, it just has a print statement over there. So what's the execution cycle for awk? Very similar to sed. It's going to read one line from input, perform this command on that line, and write the output. It's not going to write the output. So sed writes the output automatically. So in awk, it does not print the output to standard output by itself. It just reads the line and performs this command. And once the commands are complete, it's going to go to the next line. So here, our command happens to print the line on standard output. So whatever line it's going to read, it's going to write that line to standard output. It's a very simple program. The awk is going to loop over each line, read a line, write it to screen, go to the second line, write it to screen. It works like cat. Let's do something more with this. And before we go into more awk, we'll have to talk about things called records and fields. Now, awk reads files in terms of records and fields. Okay, so what's a record? So the unit in which it reads, so what's the unit it reads in over here? What does it read at a time? In one cycle, what does it read? How much data does it read? One line, right? One line worth of data is going to read. So this one line is called a record. That one unit which it reads at a time before processing is called a record. And then once it reads a record, awk is going to split that record into fields. Now by default, awk uses spaces as a separator for fields. So whenever awk sees a space in a line, so suppose awk is going to read this line, it reads the first record, and scanning through this record, it sees there's a space over there. One or more spaces, it can be tabs or spaces, anything. So when awk sees a space, it knows that field 1 is over and field 2 is beginning. And then it sees one more space and knows that field 2 is complete and field 3 begins. So it does this automatically. It reads the line, splits it into fields. Right? So this is fields and each line is a record. So from now on, we'll talk about records and fields instead of lines and words because that's more accurate. But in your mind, until we get to the last example, you can just think of a record as a line and you can think of a field as a word within that line.
So it reads just spaces or tabs also?
Tabs also. So any white space. You can have any white space separating the words. So it can be spaces or tabs. It can be even one or more space. Now, I told you about the awk execution cycle. It's going to read a record. It's going to split that record into fields. Where is it going to store these fields which it reads? So there are some special variables in awk. See? So once awk reads a record, it's going to split the record into fields, and it's going to store the first field in this variable, $1. And the second field in $2, and so on. So if you have 10 fields, you're going to have $1, $2, $3, up to $10. So it's going to split these fields. So let's use that in an example. Look at this example. Same as the earlier program, but instead of putting just the print statement, we'll print $1. What does $1 have? So it's going to read this line and split it. What is the C going to have? It's going to have $1. This is going to go into $2. This is going to go $3. This is going to go into $4. Because they're separated by white space. So if you put print $1, awk is going to read each line, print the first field, and then go on to the next line. So you'll see that we've easily removed the first column. Okay, we've extracted the first column of our data. So awk is good at these kind of things. Now you can do a lot more. Now look at this. What does this do? We put print $4, $3, $2, $1. Okay, it's just going to reverse the columns. Okay, you have your input file, it's just going to reverse the columns. So you have your last column first and your first column at the end. Okay, very easy. And you'll notice that I put commas in between here, between each variable. Okay, when you put those of you who have programmed earlier will know this, that you put just commas between variables. But by putting a comma, the print statement is going to put exactly one space separating each field. Okay, it's going to print out field number 4. It's going to print field $4. It's going to print one space, and then field 3, and then field 2, and then 1. But you can notice that in our original file, we had more than one space. Maybe even tabs. But all those tabs and spaces are lost when you print it out like this. Okay, it just puts a single space. Now suppose you wanted some space over there. You wanted more space. So in awk if you type something like this, okay, you put two variable names with nothing in between. Okay, no operator, no plus, no minus, nothing. This, if you type something like this, this automatically means concatenation. Okay, it's just gonna join the contents of both of them together. Okay? So you don't even have to put a space over here. You can just type $1, $2. Just like we've typed over here. See? There's $2, $1. Without any spaces. So what does, when you type two variables or two constants, so constants can be numbers or strings, anything. If you just type them side by side, it means concatenation. So look at this. The second and the first column are just joined together. So you can see that the last column is just joined to it, the C, right? Okay, so that's concatenation. And here we have the variable 4, which contains the fourth field. Now we have a string here which contains some spaces. Now if you put a string and a variable next to each other, that's also concatenation. So it's gonna concatenate, it's gonna join the spaces to the value in $4, and then it's gonna join the value of $3 to that, and then it's gonna join these two tabs into that $2, $1. So no commas over here. Okay, we're putting our own spaces. We don't want print statement of awk to do the making the spaces, we're doing it ourselves. So we're putting some extra space. So see, you can put any number of spaces that you like, depending on how you like your output. Now, this is just to remind you of what the original input file looks like. We're going to do some more. Okay, so I said awk is a general purpose language. You can write anything in it. So awk supports variables. It supports functions and all that kind of stuff. So variables is important for us. Sed didn't have variables. So we have variables over here now, just like we had in a shell. So we're going to use those variables to write a script that calculates the averages of the second, third, and fourth fields for each line. So what we're going to do, we're going to write a script which will take these three numbers, calculate the average, and then print it out. Right? Simple. So this is a per line calculation. We'll read one line, calculate the average, write it out, second line, read the average. So this is what that script looked like. It looks a little big. Okay. So we split it over two lines. Okay, so awk script begins over here. This is a simple variable assignment, just like in the shell. Okay, what does it do? It takes a value in the second field. $2 has a second field, right? And puts it in variable 1. Then it takes, now we're separating each statement of your program by a semicolon, just like the shell. Okay? Very similar to the shell. So we're putting a semicolon, that means the end of this statement. It's just going to assign the value of $2 to variable 1. We're going to do the same thing for $3. We're storing in variable 2. $4 in value 3. Semicolon. Now this is a feature of bash. If you type an opening bracket and don't close it and you press enter, you're going to get the secondary prompt. Remember the secondary prompt? So that means it's going to tell you to continue. So we'll just continue on the second line. And now we'll calculate your average. We're taking variable 1 plus 2 plus 3 by 3. And we're going to assign that value to the variable average. Okay, simple programming syntax. And then we're going to print that variable. Now we have all of this inside our block. So what is awk going to do? Awk is going to read a line, run this entire program on that line. And then once it's done printing the average, it's going to go to the next line and do it again. So this is the output you're going to get. The average.
Like in bash script, where when you are using the variable after assignment, you are able to say
yes.
$var1, $var2.
Yes, yes, yeah. Sorry. Yes, I should have mentioned that. So you must have noticed that we're creating the average variable here. Okay, the average variable is being assigned to here. But here when you're putting print average, we're not using a dollar in front of it. So you remember in the shell, whenever you wanted to substitute a variable with its actual value, you need to put a dollar over there. But over here, we don't need to do that. So in this respect, awk is closer to other languages like C and Fortran.
There also, like in shell bash, we would write $var1, $var2, right? In
secondary prompt line.
Over here, yes, over here you would have to use yes. Because we are referencing the variable which you created earlier. Yeah, exactly.
And it can tolerate spaces.
Sorry?
It can tolerate spaces.
Yes, yes. So spaces also are fine over here. You remember in the shell, when you had an assignment, you can't put spaces on either side of the equal to. Because the shell is going to think that there are three different commands. So over here, spaces and all are fine. And remember, just like the set command, we're putting everything in between single quotes so that the shell doesn't do anything. Okay, so suppose you put some other type of, suppose you didn't quote it, the shell is going to see $phone is going to substitute something over there. Okay, so we don't want the shell to do anything, we're putting single quotes. So this program finds the average. Good. Now suppose we wanted to find the totals of these columns across the column. So you want to find the total of this column, the total of this column, and the total of this column. Three columns, you want to find the totals. Now how do you do that? Now we have a problem because our awk script is reading line by line. And we need to somehow accumulate the values on each row. Right? We need to save them somewhere. So we need to create some variable, and once we read the first line, we'll add it to that variable. And when we read the second line, we can add it. So you need an accumulator. So let's do that. How will you do that? So now, because our script has become really long, I've put in a script file. So exactly, you remember the sed script, how I put in a file? This is the same thing. You just write the script inside a file and run it with awk-f. Just like you ran sed-f, awk-f, and the name of the script file. So this is what the script file looks like when you put it in a file. There's one thing I want to bring your attention to, something unrelated, even when I was teaching you bash scripting, and that is indentation. Okay, you notice that when I begin a block, I always put a few spaces for all the lines which are within that block. You noticed? So all the three lines which are within a block are indented by a little bit. And over here also. So I did that in shell also. When I started a for loop, or I in something, like this, all the statements which are inside, I put like a... And then I put... So you have a do here. So you see how I indented the, okay? So you need to do, what we notice usually is that many people neglect this. It makes your program really unreadable. Putting all your statements on the same line makes your program unreadable. So why do we do this? Suppose your for loop was nested. Suppose you had a for loop within another for loop. So we'll have something like this. We'll have for I in list 1, and you have some statements here, x equals to y, something y equals to 3. Then you have another for loop for j in list 2. You have to have a do over here. Okay. Do, z equals to 4. See, whenever I start a block, everything inside that block gets indented. When you start a new block, again, everything gets indented a little more. So just by looking at this file, if you just look at this file, you can easily identify that these two statements are within this block. Okay? And these two statements are within this block. Now, if I put this for loop like that, okay, just flush to the left, it's kind of difficult to see that this for loop is nested within this one. Okay, it looks like you might initially think that it's one for loop followed by another for loop. And that makes it very difficult to find the structure of a program. So whenever you write programs, try to follow this as much as possible. Whenever you start a block, just do indentation so that it's clear that this for loop begins over here. You just move your eyes straight down, you know that the block ends over here. So this for loop is between these two. And if you look here, you know that the for loop ends over here. Now if you had the done over here, you would have to match the done with the for and try to find out where it's beginning and ending. It makes it very difficult. So, yeah, sorry about that. I just wanted to mention that.
Is it possible to write this entire column like 90 degree rotation, like transpose?
Okay. We'll show you the example.
Is it easy to add as printed row wise that comes as a column?
Okay, we'll show you this program and you can judge for yourself whether this is simpler or whether what you are saying is simpler. So we'll show you this way first. How can you do it? So look at this program. Now what we need to do is we have a special block. We have a special block called the begin block. Now you can have more than, you can have one or more blocks in your awk program. So here we have a thing called a begin block. So what's special about this begin block? So what is the execution cycle of awk? Read a line, execute the statements within the block, print out, that's it. Okay. What's special about the begin block? The begin block executes only once. And before the first line is read. Okay. So you're going to pipe some file into awk, or you're going to run awk on some file. Before any input is read, whatever statements are within the begin block are executed first. And only once. Okay. It's going to be executed once before everything else, and that's it. Only once. And now this block is not a begin block, it's just a regular block. It's going to be executed for every line. So what happens when you run something like this? When you run something like this, your begin block is going to be executed before any line is read from the input. So what does this begin block do? It just creates these three variables and assigns 0 to them. Yes, yes. Which is the begin?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's case sensitive. So it has to be capital B. So what does it do? Before reading any input, it's just going to create these three variables. Now the rest of the program is just like whatever I showed you earlier. Each line is going to be read and the statements are going to be executed. So I think it's not seen. So the second block contains these statements. It just contains a line like this. Okay. And the same thing for $4. And the last line is print. Okay. This is what's inside the second block. For those who can't see it. So what does it do? It's going to read a line. Awk is going to read a line. It's going to perform these three operations. What's it going to do? It's going to take variable 1 total and add the value in $2 to it. So this syntax is familiar with everybody. What does this syntax mean? This syntax is exactly the same as writing this. So var1 equals to var1 plus 2. We're adding to it. Whatever value it contains, we're adding to it. So this is like a shorthand syntax for that. Plus equals to. So what does it do? It's going to read a line. It's going to add the value of field 2 into that total. It's going to add the value of field 3 and 4 also to their specific totals. And then it's going to print out the total. So what's the output you're going to get? So what does this print do? It's going to print variable 1 total, variable 2 total, 3 total.
At every, after reading every line, it will print.
Yeah, it's going to print the total. So you'll get something like a running total. You get something like this. Okay, so you got the total for the first line, total for the second line, third line. This is not exactly what you want, right? You want to print the complete totals, just the whole totals. So how will you do that? Now the begin block has a corresponding block called the end block. Okay? The end block. So how is the end? Oh, I'm sorry, you can't see it here. So what's the end block? The end block is exactly like the begin block. But you remember the begin block runs at the beginning of the program before any line is read. The end block is run after every line is read, when the program completes. Okay? So the end block is always the last thing to be executed. The statements within the end block are always the last statements to be executed, and executed only once. So let's write an end block. So the top part of the program is exactly the same, but we remove that print statement and we move this print statement into an end block. So you have an end block. The end block begins here. And you can put the brace here or up here. It's neater over here. And you put a print over here. Okay. This is the end block. So now your program is going to do the same thing. It's going to find the totals as it loops through all the lines. When it hits the last line, when it reaches the last line, it's going to execute that print statement. So now you get what you expect. The totals for the columns. So they're done with that example.
Yeah. So this
be ended one line by enter.
In your input?
Yeah, in the input. Earlier we had ended one line with semicolon.
Yes, yes. So we'll come to that. So I talked about records and fields. In the end of this, we'll be coming to more generalized records and fields. So this is the default. One line is one record, and the record is split into fields, which are words within that line. Now, you remember in Sed we had addresses which can restrict commands to certain to execute on certain lines. And so Awk also supports the same thing, but they call it with a different name. They call it patterns. They call it patterns, but just for convenience sake, we'll also call it addresses. We just call it addresses. So you can provide addresses also to Awk blocks. So you have a block like this. You can put a, you can use an address so that that block is executed only for lines or records, only for records that satisfy some particular condition. Now, in Sed you could put a line number over there, right? But in Awk you can't do that. You can't put a directly a line number. So where do you put the pattern? Suppose you wanted some condition, you would put it just before the block, exactly like the Sed. You remember for Sed we put two curly brackets and then you have Sed commands and then close brackets. So same thing. We put a pattern over here, the address. Now, obviously you can't put an address for the end and the begin block. Because the end and begin block don't, you can't specify addresses for those two blocks. They always run at the beginning and the end of your script. Now a pattern, an address in Awk, unlike Sed, can be any expression. It can be any expression. You can write a mathematical expression. Like you can write A equal to B, A equal to equal to B or something. Okay, any expression that returns a true or false value. If that value is true, that block of commands is executed for that line, for that record. Or it can be a regular expression. So that's similar to the Sed. Remember in Sed we put a regular expression in between forward slashes. And if that regular expression matches that record, it's going to execute. So the same thing, the regex is not different from the Sed. It's the exact same thing. Or you can even put a range. Okay. So expression 1, expression 2, separated by commas. What it does is, it's going to execute the commands in that block for all the lines in between expression 1 and expression 2. So the first line that matches expression 1 up to the first line that matches expression 2. In the examples, it becomes clear how they work. Now look at this. We put a regular expression here, just like we put for Sed. It's the exact same. This is the same program we showed you in the beginning, just an awk and a print statement. But instead of just writing print, before the block began, we put a regular expression over there. You remember the anchor? The anchor? And a C. So what does it look for? It looks for a C at the beginning of the line. Okay. So see, it prints only the lines which have a C at the beginning. So this is how an address works in Awk. Very simple. Now look at this. Suppose you want to negate that regular expression. You put a not before it. Now Sed it was opposite. You have to put the not after it, right? You have to put the exclamation mark after the address. But here it's before the address. And see, it print all the lines which are not having C in it. Now Awk has, quickly go through, Awk has certain variables which are set automatically by Awk itself while it's running. These are NF, okay, NR, NR, these are some of them. So what does it do? As Awk is processing input, it's going to set these variables values and you can use these values. So for example, NF is the number of fields in your current line. So it doesn't, so Awk is not limited to processing lines which have 4 columns or 5 columns. For example, your first line could have 3 columns, your second line could have 8 columns, it can change. So this NF variable contains a number of fields which are in your current line which is being processed. And the NR is the record number, so it tells you which record number it is processing right now. For in our case, it's a line number. Right? Since our record is a line, the NR is going to have the line number. Now these are variables which you can set, record separator, field separator. We'll be coming to that in the end of the Awk class. So look at this. What does this line do? So I told you earlier that an address can be any expression that returns true or false. So NR is what? NR is a record number. That means a line number we're currently processing. This is a modulus operator. That means it does a division and returns a remainder. Okay? So NR modulo 2 is going to divide by 2 and return the remainder. And we're checking if that remainder is equal to 0. So what does that mean? Even lines, right? We're looking for lines that are even. So if you run this command, you're going to get all the lines that are even. You're going to get line 2, 4, 6, so on.
Expression is not in slashes.
No, so if you see, so you remember earlier I told you that what's the difference between a 2 and a 2. So when the awk sees a slash like this, it knows that it's a regular expression. But if you type something without slashes, that's a plain expression. Okay, so it can, so this should be some, so if you put a 2 over here, suppose you just put a 2 over here, what's going to happen? So I told you that awk doesn't support line numbers directly. This is the only way you can use line numbers in awk. So if you put a 2, what's going to happen? We'll end with that. So what does a 2 do? So it looks for an expression which evaluates to true or false, right? So this evaluates to true whenever you have an even line. Suppose you put 2, just 2, or 1. Suppose you put 1. It's going to print every line. Why? Because that expression is true. If you put a 0 over here, just a 0, that means it's false. So if you put a 2, that means it's a 2 itself is an expression which returns the what? It returns the value 2. So awk is going to look at that value. Any non-zero value is true. So it's always true. It's going to print every line.
2 is equal to 0.
Okay, just a number 2. Just a number 2. If you put just a number 2. Okay, so you got, so this is how you print lines in particular lines that you want in awk. So very different from sed. But this syntax shows you that you can put much more powerful expressions over here. You can test much more complex conditions for lines or records over here when you're using awk. Okay, it's not limited like sed. Let's say you can only put a regular expression or a line number. Okay, I think we better start.